قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم: تلك الدار الآخرة نجعلها للذين لا يريدون علوا في الأرض ولا فسادا والعاقبة للمتقين. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى: من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه، فمنهم من قضى نحبه، ومنهم من ينتظر، وما بدلوا تبديلا. ويقول ربنا في القرآن الكريم: ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. الحمد لله رب العالمين. We are still talking about Sufism, the true Sufis, the Sufi claimers. We clarified all these matters, and then we talked about the descriptions of the true Sufis. And yesterday we started another chapter of our topic, which is about Awliyaullah Ta'ala, which is about the highly righteous Muslims that we call in Arabic Awliyaullah in plural. In plural we say Awliya, and for one we say Wali if he was a man, for example, masculine, male. If he was male, you say Wali. If the highly righteous person is a female, you say Waliyah. And yesterday we said that al-wilaya, which is the state of being a highly righteous Muslim, is not restricted on men. Meaning, among the highly righteous Muslims, there are women and there are men. And also, it's not restricted on the people who are pubescent. Rather, you might have a waliullah that is not even pubescent. Even sometimes, there were some prophets who became prophets and they weren't even pubescent. Like who? Who was the prophet who got prophethood before being pubescent? Yahya alayhi salam. Prophet Yahya alayhi salam was a prophet even before being pubescent. So in the state of wilaya, yes, it might be that a person is a wali, or a girl is a waliya, even before being pubescent. An example for a waliya was Lady Maryam alayha as-salam. She was a waliya before even being pubescent. And among the boys, there were Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, Ahmad al-Rifa'i radiyallahu anhuma. You have Al-Hasan ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu wa an abihi, wa Al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhuma. They were awliyaullah even before being pubescent. And also, the state of wilaya is not restricted on human beings. Rather, all the angels are awliyaullah. All the angels are awliyaullah. Every single angel Allah created is a wali. Azrael, the angel of death, is a wali. He's not a devil. Munkar, Nakir, angels of question, they are awliya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a whole group of angels. Everyone among them is called Munkar, 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 Munkar. Another group of angels, everyone among them is called Nakir, 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 Nakir. They are a bunch, يعني, a lot, a big number. But what I want to say is that all of these angels are awliyaullah. So if you understand the importance and the high rank of Awliyaullah, you would be keen to make yourself susceptible of their dua. يعني, like we said yesterday when we prayed Al-Maghrib, after you finish your prayer and saying the second Assalamu Alaikum, don't rush to stand up. Don't be like some who you see saying Assalamu Alaikum Warahmatullah, and while standing up Assalamu Alaikum Warahmatullah, why you're rushing? Stay where you are at. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said what means that the person who finishes his prayer, as long as he is in that position, يعني on his knees, he is in the position, whether on his knees or sitting down, depending on his case, if he stays on that position without changing his position nor talking the current talk, how are you, hi, where are you going, where are you at, as long as he stays in that position and doesn't speak the common speech, there will be an angel on top of his head that will make dua for him until he changes his position or speak the common speech. So it's like a volonté, we say in French. Dua from an angel, a volonté. All you want dua, Allah. All you want dua. How much dua you want, ya akhi? Stay 5 minutes, 5 minutes dua of a wali that never disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The angel is a wali. So the wali is making dua, is supplicating for you in your favor. Allahu Akbar. Asking Allah for you to be merciful upon you, to forgive you, to facilitate for you, to bless you. Allah. So the one who understands the high rank of Awliyaullah, he will make himself susceptible to their dua. And this is common, يعني among us. If we know now that there is a wali, let's say, in Halab, Syria, or in Beirut, we travel to go see him. Why? Why we go visit a wali? In order for us to have his barakah, in order for us to have the benefit of his supplication. Isn't that right? You travel from here to Beirut sometimes not to visit an alive wali, sometimes just to visit his grave, his tomb, and you travel. Allahu Akbar. So the one who knows the high rank of Awliyaullah will make himself susceptible to their dua. Hayda, يعني only this subject, we can speak about it 2 hours, subhanallah al-azim. And it's a beautiful, Allah, it's a beautiful subject. Why? Because you don't need any human permission to have the blessings of that wali that is an angel. It is not like going from here to Halab, here to Hummus, here to Indonesia to visit that wali, to seek his blessings, to seek his dua, and then once you are there, someone on the door tells you, who are you? You cannot see him. Allahu Akbar. I've been traveling for the past 40 hours to reach Indonesia, and now you tell me the wali is behind the door and I cannot see him? How do you feel? Sometimes your heart is broken, ya Rajul. Amma, when you are thinking like what I'm telling you, inno seeking the blessings and the dua of the angels, you don't need any human permission. You just say after your prayer, sitting down, and a wali among the awliya of Allah will supplicate for you for 1 hour if you stay sitting down. How much barakah will you have? Subhanallah al-azim. Allah, 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 Allah. Also in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said what means that any Muslim who supplicate in the back of his brother Muslim, meaning without telling him, not in his face, in his back, while you are going to the hotel or to your house, you see, for example, brother, let's say, Hajj Ilyas, buying food from the food truck. From your car, you look at him, you say, "Oh Allah, make him among those who enter paradise without any torture." Prophet Muhammad taught us that because you do this, an angel will say, "Ameen," and I ask Allah for you the same. Shu Habibi, what do you want? You are sick? Look among the Muslims, who's sick? And behind his back, يعني without him knowing, open your hands and say, اللهم اشفه, اللهم عافه, اللهم اشفه, اللهم عافه, اللهم اشفه شفاء لا يغادر سقما. You want to see Prophet Muhammad? Choose anyone among the Muslims behind his back without telling him, اللهم ارزقه رؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, اللهم عطف قلب نبيك عليه. Shuf, Islam teaches you to have a kind heart, a good heart, because doing supplication for someone without asking anything in return and without him knowing even that you are supplicating for him needs you to be sincere and honest, really. And it's beautiful just by remembering that the angel, a wali among the awliya of Allah, will say, "Ameen. I ask Allah for you the same. Allah, Allah, you have debts. Check who has debts among the Muslims. Oh Allah, make him able to pay his debt. Ya Allah, give him more sustenance. Ya Allah, give him more money." The angel will say, "Ameen, walaka bil mithl." Allah, how beautiful is Islam. Shifat kif hayde? Shifat, are you touching something? This is the way of true Sufis. Do you understand? It's Sheikh, like your body needs food. Your soul needs these things. Your soul needs to hear these things in order for you to excel in training yourself. Allah says in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. يعني he is victorious and he is a winner, the one who trains himself to be better. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. يَا سَلَام. Working on yourself. Self-development. Understand? Work on yourself. Also, another great meaning. هيك, I want you to touch those meaning. يعني هيك, feel them. Feel them. Another great meaning we find in the hadith of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Ya Habibi, Ya Rasul Allah. Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam said, anyone, meaning a Muslim, anyone going in the day to visit a Muslim sick person, any Muslim who goes out to visit a sick Muslim, 70,000 angels will accompany him and will make for him dua, and he has a garden in paradise. They will make dua until when, Ya Rasulullah? The Prophet clarified, they will make dua for that person who visited the sick Muslim until sunset. And if he goes out to visit the sick Muslim after sunset, they will go with him and they will keep on doing dua until dawn. Imagine now in the winter time, Al-Maghrib starts, let's say, at 5 o'clock, let's say. You pray Maghrib and then right away you go visit a sick Muslim. 70,000 angels will go with you. 70,000 angels, who? خرج معه, النبي said. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام said, خرج معه. يعني will go with that person. 70,000 angels that will make dua for him until dawn. And look, dawn now is at what time? It's about 6 o'clock in the morning. Imagine at 5:30 afternoon you went to visit that sick, and then you came back home, you prayed al-Isha, and you slept at 10 o'clock, but the angels sleep. Touch these meanings. The angels sleep, ya akhi, they don't sleep. Imagine you sleeping, and you were accompanied by 70,000 angels, and the angels won't sleep, and they will continue to make dua for you while you are sleeping. How about that? How about that? Are you touching it? Are you heck? Is your soul being affected? This is true Sufism. Do you understand? We could have said, the one who goes out and visit a sick person, 70,000 angels will go with him. They will make dua for him until sunset, and he has a garden in paradise. And then we open the page and we talk about something else. Sufism, true Sufism, is when you go more, when you taste. Do you understand? You taste something from the hadith. You repeat the hadith. You understand the hadith even more. You ponder about the hadith. You apply the hadith. You consider the hadith. You put the hadith between your eyes. You make an intention to apply that hadith, implementing the teachings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And after that, let me see your face. Will you be miserable or depressed if you think like that? How can you be depressed while 70,000 angels are with you and making dua for you? And nowadays, the most sickness now in the society, depression. Depression. I'm not happy. Why you're not happy? Why you're not happy? One day a brother came to me. He said, Sheikh Gil, make me dua. He was very like, Sheikh, in Canada. In Canada where you have everything you want. And even if you don't have, the government will supply for you. Subhanallah al-Azim. Heck, heck. He came as if somebody is dead in his يعني, family. Nobody is dead. He has a nice car, nice house. He has everything, like most of us. He said, Sheikh Gil, I feel bad. I'm depressed. Make dua for me. I'm not feeling good. I told him, and I have cancer. How are you? He said, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. I told him, are you happy? Alhamdulillah. Say Alhamdulillah. Instead of seeing what doesn't work in your life, look at the things that are working in your life. And on top of all these is what? Your Islam. This is the best endowment Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gives his slaves. And Allah, without him being obligated to do so, he gave it to you. You're Muslim. How about this endowment? I don't feel good. The shaitan is laughing on you. The shaitan is laughing on you. And most of those people who come say, Sheikh, make dua, are among those people who saw Prophet Muhammad in their dream once or many times. You saw Prophet Muhammad in the dream. You guaranteed entering paradise without any torture. And you are sad. You are depressed in this dunya and for this dunya, poor you, like the shaitan himself is laughing at you. If this is your case, the shaitan laughs at you. You guaranteed the entry of paradise without torture and you're depressed. For what? For a bill you cannot pay? For a girl who doesn't want you in marriage? For some money that you lost? For a house that is not very nice? Because you didn't have enough likes on your post on Instagram? You're depressed, you're sad, poor you! You need to learn more about true Sufism and touch all these meanings. You will feel, you will live a happy life. Do you understand? How can you be depressed? Look, Sheikh, if you know 70,000 angels are with you. Kif, ya Sheikh, kif? And I want to ask you a question. How about if somebody among you, if someone among you, now when he leaves this session and he will go to the hotel or to his house, how about if 70 guards will go with him? 70 guards will go with him. How he will walk on the street? How he will walk? Don't you feel strong if you have 70 guards, let's say? How about 70,000 angels who are walking with you? This is why awliyaullah, even when they walk on the land that Allah Ta'ala created, they don't walk in a common way. You look at him, you feel like an army of lions is like walking with him. You look at him, he has an awe stronger than the awe of a king. Why? Why? He has a gun? No. He has piety. He has taqwa. He has taqwa. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? So how can you feel sad if you really, your heart is remembering that now 70,000 angels went out with me to visit that sick and they will stay with me until dawn, if you left يعني, after sunset. Or they will stay with me until sunset. How can you be sad? Islam is great, Sheikh. Wallahi, Islam is great. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most generous, without him being obligated to grant me Islam, to grant us Islam, he granted us Islam. And Allah, without him being obligated to facilitate for us the acts of worship, facilitated for us. And Allah, without him being obligated to strengthen us to be able to pray and do the acts of worship, he strengthened us. And he is the one who reward us, and he is the one who makes us enter paradise. After that, after thinking like that, how dare you? How won't you be shy to disobey him subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah, are you touching something? Heck, are you feeding your soul? Are you nourishing your soul? This is true Sufism. This is the color that we miss. This is the touch that we want after acquiring the obligatory knowledge. Another example. In the hadith also, Prophet Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام said, what means that the one who says only three times, أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم, three times, and then he recites the last three verses of Surah Al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make 70,000 angels make dua for him until sunset, if he said that during the day. And if he said that after sunset, 70,000 angels will do dua for him until dawn. Imagine being asleep, you slept at midnight, and the angels for 6 hours until dawn, they don't sleep, they are making dua for you. How will your life be? Isn't it that Ahl al-Dunya, they feel proud of themselves? Ana, he tells you, I have a company that generates income for me 24 hours a day. Mahak, because he has a business online and people are buying from different country with the difference of time, isn't that right? So he feels successful and he feels happy. He brags about ana, income comes in my bank for, yani, 24 hour long. Understand? Whether I am asleep or not, I have merchandise that is being sold and money is coming to the bank. He feels good. So how about you if you think you are asleep and you are having the dua of the angels? The meaning of your life changed, ya Habib Albi. Do you understand? See how your life is, just by listening to this, you feel good. So how about practicing it? You always have to remember, ilm wa amal. Understand knowledge and implementing what you learned. This is why I told you four sessions before. The true Sufis are like, they are not with us. Their body is with us, but it's like they are not with us, Sheikh. And some of them, they are so in this to the point that they lose their, yani they become insane. في حب الله, in the love of Allah, they become insane. Subhanallah al-Azim, Allahu Akbar, Sheikh. So if you understand the high rank of awliyaullah, you will make yourself susceptible to their dua. How? You don't rush to stand up after your prayer. You finish your prayer, you stay, make dua. The angel will do dua for you. You go visit sick people. Now if I tell you, who among you visited a sick person and when was it the last time? Most of us maybe didn't visit a sick person from before COVID. Isn't that right? We don't have this habit, but if we merge this habit in our daily life, our bond in al-jam'iyya as brotherhood, our brotherhood will be stronger. Not only the jam'iyya, but with the Muslims in general. Sheikh Ahmed al-Rifa'i al-Kabir, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he used to hear that someone is sick among the Muslims, even if he was in a different village, Sheikh Ahmed al-Rifa'i used to go visit him. Used to do ziyarat al-marid. Who? Ahmed al-Rifa'i. Sheikh Ahmed al-Rifa'i used himself with his own blessed hands. Go bring the na'l, bring the shoes of the blind students that were listening to his lesson. This is how modest and humble he was. وهذا أحمد الرفاعي الكبير. He, Sheikh Ahmed al-Rifa'i رضي الله تعالى عنه, he used to go visit those who have جذام. جذام, دكتور, شو يعني؟ Leprosy, you say? It's something horrible. In the past, sometimes you have a judam that goes, for example, in a society, like 50,000 people will die because of it. It's not easy. Judam, back then, يعني you don't approach, you don't touch. It's worse than COVID. Sheikh Ahmed al-Rifa'i used to go to those people that are having a judam. He used to wash their clothes and prepare for them food and eat with them. And then he used to leave them, asking them dua for Ahmed al-Lash al-Lash. Allahu Akbar Kabira. Allahu Akbar Kabira. And he is Ahmed al-Rifa'i. Allahu Akbar Kabira. The more knowledge you have, you are more inclined to be humble. Do you understand? This is how it is. So look at Imam Ahmed al-Rifa'i. This is how we should be. We should ask about each other. You see, for example, one brother didn't come to the Dawra and he was your friend last Dawra. You call him, what's up, brother? Everything is fine. If he is sick, you make dua for him. If he needs help, you help him. And if he is fine, he will be happy that you asked about him. And this is how al-jam'iyya becomes stronger. And this is how we feel يعني, better to be together. Our heart will be more pure, because my salam to any among you is different after a visit. Now, for example, let's say I see brother Abu Ahmed or brother Rashid. Assalamu alaikum, brother Rashid. Everything is fine. But if I go visit him in his house, the next time I see him after the visit, assalamu alaikum, how are you? More warmth, more bond. Heck, Sheikh Abdullah, heck he used to do. Sheikh Abdullah didn't run the da'wah on WhatsApp. He didn't run a da'wah on internet. He didn't. You tell me, no internet back then. Ya khayye, there wasn't phones? Mbala. You tell me, but it was war, no phones. Ya khayye, there weren't talkie-walkies? Mbala. He didn't run a da'wah with talkie-walkies. Sheikh Abdullah himself used to go and visit our brothers. Sheikh Abdullah opened his house for the brothers to come. Some of our top sheikhs now used to be among those kids who used to jump on the bed of Sheikh Abdullah al-Habashi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa rahimahu. Heck, the da'wah will grow. How we're gonna bring people? Just by merely sending a message? No, if that person that you want to bring is in the village or in the city, go visit him. You know lots of us how they were recruited to Al-Jam'iyya or brought to a lesson, right? You know how? There was a asir called Asir Ramadan, Atari Jdidi. Our brothers, what did they used to do? Even though our brothers were poor, they didn't have credit cards like us and money like us now. La, they were poor. But they used to pay for someone new. What do you have now? Are you busy? No, I'm not busy. I'm inviting you Asir Ramadan. He goes to Asir Ramadan. Our brother buys a small glass for him of juice. And he buys the pieces of cocktail, the big one, the Bermil one, the big one, for the new. Because while he is eating, our brother takes advantage of his mouth full and he teaches him al-aqidah and the importance of learning Islam. And because he invited him, normally the one who is invited won't tell you, shut up, I don't want to hear anymore. He will feel shy. He will be shy to tell you, stop, I don't want to hear you anymore. But you're inviting him, and the cocktail shaf is that big, with ashta on top and some honey. Subhanallah al-azim. Shuf, subhanallah. Our brothers were very, very, very poor. Despite that, look at what they used to do. This is how Al-Jam'iyyah grew. Al-Jam'iyyah didn't grow on internet. Do you understand? Didn't grow by messages. Innama it grew by the effort of those people, our brothers who were before us, and they put the effort to go visit the poor and go visit the sick and go to a funeral or going to a jinaza. They put a lot of effort. Jazahumullahu anna khayra. This is how we should be. Tab, you tell me, Sheikh, I'm not motivated to do so. What you're hearing today about the angels that will go with the one who is gonna visit a sick is enough for you as a motivation. If this doesn't motivate you, go check your heart. Maybe you're dead. طيب بس يا شيخ, why our heart is not motivated sometimes? Why we don't feel this? We are not touched. You know why? Because some of us is far from at-taqwa, is far from dhikrullah. Ala bi dhikrillah tatma'innu al-qulub. كلا بل ران على قلوبهم. There is certain thing called ran. A ran is like dirt on your heart. The more sins you do, it's like this ran will engulf your heart until if he drinks vodka or water, it will be the same. If he prays or not, it will be the same. Before the ran engulfing his heart, if he leaves out an obligatory prayer, he might think that now the earth will open and swallow him. Understand? He fears, but because he did it one time after the other, sins, ran, khalas, his heart became like he drinks vodka or he drinks water, it's the same for him. He leaves out the prayer. And sometimes, if you tell him, come pray jama'ah, he tells you, look, ما بيستحي. He's not shy to tell you, Sheikh, I'm not praying these days, make dua for me. You're not praying, you're close to be a kafir. We fear that you die as a kafir because you don't pray. You are mal'oon if you don't pray. You are a damned person. You are very far from the good. You are a major sinner. You are not trustworthy. You don't pray and you're not shy to talk about it. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because the heart became hard. Type. This hardness, how can we take it off? Tawbah ilallah and dhikr. Tawbah, of course, with doing the obligations, prayer and so on, but adding dhikr. Dhikr. Until it will wash your heart. After that, your heart is clean. You don't stop. You continue dhikr, so your heart will be like a land that is labored and now is ready to have the grains and grow trees. This is how it is. Are you touching this meaning of Sufism? Do you understand? With your mukhtasar, with your obligatory knowledge, you add this practice of true Sufism, like our Sheikh, inshallah, he will go far. Do you understand? So, we were saying that men and women can be awliyaullah. It's not restricted on grown-ups. Rather, before being accountable and after being accountable, the person could be a wali. And al-wilaya is not restricted on the human beings. All the angels were awliyaullah. Every single angel is a wali. Ya salam, ya Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, ma yalfidhu min qawlin illa ladayhi raqibun atid. Everything that you are doing, everything that you are believing, everything you are thinking about and saying is written by one of the two angels, Raqib and Atid. Raqib and Atid are what? Awliya. Best this concept, you can take a whole night just thinking about it and you will find a certain meaning. How good you will feel if you say La ilaha illallah, with sincerity in your heart, even if you are alone, even if you were tossing and turning in your own bed, while turning from side to side, you say Allah with the good intention. How will you feel when you do the good, knowing that a wali among the awliya is writing that you did something good? It doesn't encourage you to do even more. You feel good, Sheikh. You are doing it lillah, but if you touch this meaning, you will feel good, Sheikh. Subhanallah. Your body is with the people and as if you are not with them. Who among the people think like that nowadays? Rare. You do the good, Allah knows. You don't say to anybody, and the angel is writing for you. This is from a side. From another side, I'm gonna ask you a question. If you are sitting with Sheikh Abdullah, rahimahullah, the great wali of his zaman, of his time, if you were sitting with him when he was alive, for example, will you have the guts to pick your nose in the presence of Sheikh Abdullah while Sheikh Abdullah, the wali of Allah, is looking at you? Even though it's not haram. Do you understand? Picking one's nose is not haram. But you won't do it still in front of a wali. Do you understand? طيب. If Sheikh Abdullah was facing you, will you sit like that, مثلاً, opening your thighs and doing like that? Will you sit like that? No. You will be careful how you speak, how you act, how you sit, how... Isn't that right? You give your best. Why? Because you are in the presence of a wali. طيب. Will you dare to commit a sin, for example, while Sheikh Abdullah is looking at you? Or while Umar ibn al-Khattab is looking at you? Imagine Ahmed al-Rifa'i is with you in the same room, nobody is with you, and then you watch something that is not appropriate. Or you do a certain haram, whether with your body or with your tongue. يعني. How do you feel? Will you dare to do it? طيب, how can you dare to do the same sin while knowing that an angel that is a wali will write it for you? The angel, a wali, is writing, and now he's lying, and now he's backbiting. Now he is talking to that woman with the intention to commit zina. And now he was walking with her, and now he's making zina with her. Will you be shy to do it or not? You will feel shy. Are you touching something? This will make you a better Muslim. You want to go deeper? Allah is seeing you. Allah. Sometimes if you think about it, you feel like you're gonna be paralyzed. While you're doing the sin, when it comes to your mind, you feel like you're gonna be paralyzed. This is how we should think to excel, to develop ourselves, to make ourselves better. Those people who visit a sick, or who say Surah Al-Hashr, the last three verses, with what I told you before, some of them told me, that night, Sheikh, I wanted to do something that is inappropriate for me to do, even though it doesn't reach the haram. Normally, you don't do it, مثلاً, in front of a wali. So he said, I didn't do it. I felt shy. I felt shy that now 70,000 angels, Allah, without being obligated, made them make dua for me, 70,000 wali, and now I'm gonna do this inappropriate matter, or I'm gonna do this sin. You feel shy. This is enough motivation for you. If you're not motivated, go check your heart. It's beautiful or not. This is why I tell you, true Sufis, their bodies are with us, but sometimes they are not here. Are you getting something from all of this? And al-wilaya, as we said, is not restricted on humans. All angels are awliya'ullah. There is no angel that is not wali. And it's not restricted only on angels and human beings. No, but rather, even in the jinn, there are awliyaullah. Do you understand? So in the jinn, there are walis. In the angels, all of them are awliyaullah. And in humans, there are awliyaullah. So from this, you know that al-wilaya is not like prophethood. Prophethood is not by acquiring. You cannot do something to be a prophet. This is very important for you, Ilyas, to understand. Why? Because some Sufi claimers, what do they say? If you come to our tariqa, the tariqa of our sheikh, they claim, and you say what our sheikh tells you to say, you will have a higher rank than an angel, even than a prophet. And this is kufr. Allah says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ وَكَمَانْ وَكُلَّمْ فَضَّلْنَا عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. Nobody can do something to be a prophet. Do you understand? Prophethood, Allah had chose some men and Allah Ta'ala made them prophets. As for messengers, the message is not restricted on human beings only. Prophethood, only human beings and only men. There is no prophet that is a girl, not even Maryam or Fatima or Khadija, no. Prophethood is restricted on men that are humans. No prophet is a jinn. No prophet is an angel. But the message is not restricted on humans. Rather, in the angels, there are messengers. Like who? Jibreel, who is Rasulullah to Rasulullah. Who is the messenger of Allah to the messengers of Allah. And an example of that will make you, inshallah, يعني, drown in the sea of حب الله سبحانه وتعالى, يعني, if Allah Ta'ala facilitates for you. يعني, an example normally we give about this is the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, in which he said, if Allah accepts a person, إِذَا أَحَبَّ أَحَبَّ is, I'm gonna translate, if Allah accepts. Literally, if Allah loves. But you know that Allah is not attributed with feelings. So when in Arabic the Prophet says, إِذَا أَحَبَّ, it means if Allah accepts. And here, allow me to open a bracket for you. If you want to have those meanings that I'm saying even more in this domain, learn Arabic. Because if I tell you if Allah accepts, it doesn't have the same impact on your heart as when you hear it in Arabic. إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا Allah. This is why here I encourage all youth not to miss the opportunity of learning the Arabic language. No matter how much you read translations, how much you listen to the meanings of the Quran or the meanings of the Hadith, it will never be like listening and comprehending in the Arabic language that is the best language. And Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Allah facilitated for us in North America. يعني, this is something like a dream. If like somebody was speaking in America now, we have something like Aleph. If you were saying this to our brothers like 30 years or 40 years ago, it was like a dream. Now the dream became true. Now we have an institution like Aleph. It's not like coming to my house and teaching you. You can come to my house, I teach you Arabic, but it's not the same. You can go to a teacher in his house to learn algebra. But it's not like going to the school. Why? The school, they have something called pedagogy. Pedagogy, what does it mean? يعني, they have a certain curriculum. Do you understand? This institution, Aleph, has a curriculum. يعني, has stage one, stage two, three, to the point that in 4 months, you understand Arabic and you speak it. Speaking Arabic in 4 months, even if you were someone who didn't learn Islam, didn't learn the obligatory knowledge, even if you were an ignorant Muslim living in America, just adding on your CV that you speak also Arabic, this is enough motivation for you to go and learn Arabic and be certified. This is also a difference. You go to Sheikh Jil, you learn Arabic. Okay, but without a curriculum, without being tested, without need, heck, there is something more accurate in the institution. And on top of all that, you talk Arabic. Sheikh Jil, I want to go to a company, مثلا, write for me a paper that I learned Arabic. I write for you. You go, CEO tells you, who's Sheikh Jil? Marhaba. It's like nothing. It's like nothing. Amma, when you graduate from an institution, you have this diploma. And this diploma means a lot. Not only in Arabic, even in the Islamic studies. I know it's a paper. I know Abu Bakr, nobody gave him a paper as a diploma, nor Umar, nor Shafi'i. Understand? But nowadays, this helps a lot. Especially for the layman. They tell those who don't believe you when you talk about religion, for example, they will tell him, he has a certificate, he has a diploma, he's a graduate from an Islamic institution, he learned for 4 years, what do you know? He knows better. This is the importance of that piece of paper that means a lot to excel in ad-da'wah. طيب, now you tell me, but I have work. And now I tell you also that we have online. يعني you can even study that curriculum in Arabic online. Well, not only that, imagine yourself after 4 months or even less starting to read Juzu Amma alone, Al-Mukhtasar, the knowledge. Invest in your youth, khida minni. Now you are still young. Ilyas, do you have a wife that you need to give obligatory funding, obligatory, what do you say, يعني نفقة? No. Do you have kids, for example, that you need to work to give him النفقة الواجبة? Are you paying a rent or living at your parents' house? At your parents' house. Why you deprive yourself from having this opportunity of learning the Arabic in a good way and then the religion in the good way and be certified? Now, if you look at our institution that we are proud to have, alhamdulillah, look, Sheikh from America, ya Rajul, I'm not telling you from Beirut, I'm not telling you from Mecca nor Anna al-Madina. Alhamdulillah, the institution sent 30 among our brothers and sisters to Beirut to continue their knowledge. 30 from Alif, from America. 30 to defend the religion. It's not only learn Arabic. Because when you learn Arabic in a dedicated way, especially if you are here in the institution, all day long you only study. This will affect your heart later on if you are sincere. And you will see the barakah of that. Don't worry about money. Don't worry about what you're gonna work later on. I give you an example. One of the guys who used to be here in Alif, he went to Beirut, he continued there, isn't that right? He was sleeping. He was sleeping. The supervisor came to Hajj Mamadou while he was sleeping and he did like that. He poked him on his back. Hajj Mamadou, give us your papers. Somebody paid for you to go to Al-Hajj. After 3 years in Alif, even if he didn't come to Alif and he worked for 3 years, would he have saved $12,000 to go to Al-Hajj? It came. Don't worry. I know what I'm telling you. I don't have a day job, but I'm living better than many rich people. At least I'm feeling good and happy. Don't ever say, Ilyas, but what I'm gonna work later on? The pleasure of defending the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no money is equivalent to it. Normally with money you buy pleasure. There is no money that can buy this pleasure of defending the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Sheikh, but I fear what I'm gonna do later on, what I'm gonna work. Later on you might not be living. And later on, tawakkal ala Allah. Do the right thing right. Rely upon Allah. I tell you a story before we leave. There was a man in the past, when he heard that the Khalifa ordered them to go out for the jihad, his wife was pregnant. But despite that, he prepared himself and he left. How hard it is. His wife is pregnant, no phone, no WhatsApp, no internet, no way of connection. He goes, and sometimes they don't come back because they are killed in the battlefield. And sometimes they come after years. He relied upon Allah. And defending the religion was stronger than the love he had for his wife and child. The love for his religion was stronger. He left what he needs to leave for her as obligation. Understand? Nafaqa. And he relied upon Allah and he went. This is not easy, Afkara. Now you have a kid like, مثلا, mashallah, Abu Ahmed holding Ahmed now. Just to think, and I know, because when I had Amina, I was with one of our sheikhs, Sheikh Zakaria, here on the corner in a car. We were talking and then we started to talk about Al-Mahdi, like all of us, يعني, all the young ones. And then I like was daydreaming. He told me, what happened? I told him, subhanAllah, the feeling changed after I have a girl now. I have responsibility. I feel like, yeah, before I get married, it's like, yeah. Now it's like, yeah, good. So he told me why. I said, no, I have a daughter. يعني, you know, how she's still young? What she's gonna do without me? Wallah, he said something. He cured my heart. He told me, sure, heck. With disgust, يعني, he said one phrase, Allahu akramu minka alayhim. Allah is more generous upon them than you. Khalas. Until now, if the Jam'iyyah calls now, go to China from here to the airport, I won't think twice to defend the religion of Muhammad. Allah is more generous on our kids than us. Khlusna. So this man went to the jihad. He came after 18 years. He came after who? 18 years. Their habits, when they used to come from any travel, they used to go to the mosque first before they go home to pray jama'ah. He prayed behind an imam that was heck, mashallah, still young, and beautiful, handsome, and he had, يعني, mashallah, a voice that is make your heart, يعني, fly as much as is good, يعني. And then while he was praying, he had a khatir, إنه, subhanallah, if I hadn't went to jihad, maybe I would have had, يعني, seen the delivery of my wife, and I took care of my son, and he would have been an imam like him. A khatir. And then after the prayer, he spoke with the people. He went to his house. He knocked on the door and then that man opened. So he thought, lah, my wife, did she marry someone else or what? And then he saw his wife coming from behind that man saying, don't worry, this is your son. And there is a hadith that Allah will protect the kids of the pious man. Allah will protect the kids of the pious man. So don't worry. Don't ever let the shaitan tell you, eh, but you're not worried for the future. The future is already written on the guarded tablet. Rely upon Allah. Do the right decision in this age and you will see your life will be good. Inshallah, we will start the lesson next time by saying this hadith about the hub that we mentioned. Until then, I remind you to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if anybody is interested about Alif, he can ask Sheikh Saif or anyone who's responsible about this. Nuhallil wa nusalli ala al-Nabi. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. بارك الله فيكم.